At Awesomeo.com, we have a breakout player defined as an established high-level player who will exceed his prior performance and expectations as measured by average draft position going into the season. So forgive me if I'm breaking the rules or bending the rules a little bit here, because not everybody on this list is already an established high-level player. Not all of them have even played a full season at the NFL level, but all of them, in my opinion at least, are in spots to absolutely crush their ADP and put you in that money come December. So I'm Dave Lochran from AwesomeMode.com. Let's talk about it. My favorite later round breakouts, talking really 10th round or later, that I think can crush for you this season. If you like this content, hit that thumbs up. Helps me out in a huge way. And subscribe to the channel as well. Let's get started. Darnell Mooney didn't get a ton of hype during his rookie season, but that was mostly because of players like Justin Jefferson, Chase Claypool, and CeeDee Lamb having huge games and making jaw-dropping plays each week. Even T. Higgins was on pace for a big year before Joe Burrow went down. But Mooney definitely wasn't bad, finishing with 61 receptions for 631 yards and 4 touchdowns on 98 targets, all of which finished second at his position in Chicago behind Allen Robinson. You'd like to see him improve on a 62% reception rate, sure, but that's what happens when your quarterbacks are Mitch Trubisky and Nick Foles. Just to expand on that a little, here's an insane stat to illustrate just how bad Chicago quarterbacks were on deep attempts last year. Mooney was 15th in the entire league on targets of 20-plus yards, but 55th in receptions on those same plays. And according to PFF, none of those misses were drops on Mooney's part. 4 receptions on 23 targets is unacceptable. And while 7 of them were contested balls, of which Mooney only came down with 2, there's still no way we shouldn't be feeling better about his outlook for 2021, especially when Justin Fields takes over. That's the thing, though. Andy Dalton is not someone who's going to take Mooney's deep game to the next level, but Fields absolutely can. This could become a deadly connection, especially considering how often Mooney was getting open last year, only to have balls thrown at his feet or 10 rows up into empty seats. You're getting him at an ADP of 91 on Underdog, but in home leagues, you'll be able to pull Mooney way later. We're talking straight into the double-digit rounds. And late in the season, when we assume that Fields will already have been installed as the starter for quite some time now, it's going to be perfect to have Mooney on your roster. Irv Smith is coming into what many like to consider the make-or-break year for tight ends. He's posted modest production through his first 2 seasons with the Vikings, but could be primed for a breakout in 2021. Here's why. Kyle Rudolph is finally out of Minnesota, which is what makes Smith most appealing. Rudolph played more snaps than Smith in almost every game he was healthy, but Tyler Conklin is the only tight end behind him now. And while Smith's yardage totals weren't crazy in the 4 games Rudolph missed to close out the season, he did score 3 touchdowns on 6 red zone targets, which was tied for most in football at his position over that span. He was also on the field for 83% of snaps over the final 3 weeks, so there's reason to believe Smith's role could expand significantly in year 3. I'm definitely not enamored with the fact that Justin Jefferson, Adam Thielen, and Dalvin Cook are on this offense when it comes to Smith's projected workload, but he should definitely be the number 3 option in the passing game, and potentially a lot more than that inside the red zone, which is exactly what we're looking for when targeting late round tight ends, touchdown upside. And here's just one example of what Smith is capable of doing on end zone targets when they're contested. Smith has been fantastic in camp, both as a receiver and a blocker, which is what he'll need to stay on the field and make an impact. At an ADP of 127 and the 12th tight end off the board, you've got to feel good about getting him there, even if he hasn't quite proven yet that he can be that alpha tight end in this league. I don't think we need to be extremely excited about anyone on the Saints roster outside of Alvin Kamara, but Marquez Callaway deserves some attention based on his late round ADP and absence of any real competition at the wide receiver position right now. Michael Thomas is going to be sidelined for a while, and while he might be ahead of schedule, as some reports have noted, it's still expected that Thomas will miss a good amount of time to start the year. And that's not even to mention the tension arising between him and the Saints front office. Callaway has been showing out all camp and looked great in week 1 of the preseason with neither Thomas or Traquan Smith on the field. But Smith is underwhelmed in 3 years with the New Orleans Saints and is no guarantee whatsoever to be the wide receiver 1 with Thomas out, or even the wide receiver 2 when Thomas returns. Emmanuel Sanders is in Buffalo now and Jared Cook headed out west. So while the Saints offense may be unspectacular, someone will still have to catch footballs. The biggest question now is whether or not Jameis Winston will be starting ahead of Taysom Hill. And if Winston does start, how much will Hill be involved? Hill peppered Callaway with targets in week one of the preseason, and Winston is just an outright good quarterback for fantasy purposes. So either way, you're getting Callaway at a 140 ADP as the 66th receiver off the board on Underdog, and it's looking like he could be their wide receiver one to start the year. I'm not in love with his schedule to begin the season, but if Callaway is legitimately good, you'll be wishing you'd spent a late round pick on the second year receiver. I thought about going Trey Lance here, but his ADP has now climbed to 113 on Underdog, making him the 12th quarterback off the board, which means you'd be drafting him as a starter. I'm honestly fine with that because we should feel pretty confident that he'll be starting sooner or later, and there are plenty of late-round quarterbacks that you can use as placeholders to start until that happens. But the Justin Fields hype isn't quite at the level of Lance yet, and that's why I like him here, even if he's not your prototypical breakout player. And maybe the lesser hype is because he didn't rip off an 80-yard touchdown pass in his preseason NFL debut, or because the coach speak from Matt Nagy isn't as strong when it comes to Fields starting for the Bears. Nagy has reported on multiple occasions that Fields won't start over Andy Dalton in week one, but now it sounds like he might be a little more open to the idea. Nagy just said the other day that Fields will be getting more reps with the first team players and against first team defense. Even though he said he planned on doing this all along as part of an evaluation process, we can't ignore the fact that Chicago traded up in the first round to get Fields, and they're not a rebuilding team where they'll want to slowly work him into the offense if Dalton isn't playing well. Fields can sling the deep ball and really open up the offense for guys like Robinson and Mooney, and he was an accurate passer at Ohio State too. But his ability to take off and make plays with his legs is what really separates him from Dalton. He has cheat code ability for fantasy purposes and is currently the 16th quarterback going off the board with an ADP of 128 on Underdog. He's obviously someone worth monitoring throughout the remainder of the preseason, but here's the best way to look at it. If Fields was already the starter in Chicago, he'd be drafted as a top 10 quarterback. Grab him now as the QB 16 before he's the starter. If you haven't signed up for Underdog Fantasy yet, I don't know what you're waiting for. Seriously, best ball leagues are the greatest thing to fantasy football since PPR came around. I've been drafting a ton over there, from the Puppy, which is $5 to enter, $100,000 the first, or the Best Ball Mania, $3.5 million, over $1 million the first, the biggest best ball contest ever ran. It doesn't matter what style of player you are, what your bankroll looks like, they got something for everyone over at Underdog Fantasy. And when you sign up using the promo code AWESEMO, that's AWESEMO, you'll get $25 upon your first deposit. There's no reason not to check it out. You're absolutely going to love it. It works flawlessly, whether you're on an iPad, iPhone, desktop, laptop, it doesn't matter. UnderdogFantasy.com, use that promo code AWESEMO, get $25 when you sign up and deposit, and go win yourself some money. I really like Russell Gage this season, and you probably should too. His role has consistently expanded each year in three seasons with the Falcons, and now he'll be the clear number two receiver behind Calvin Ridley with Julio Jones out of the picture. And I'm not willing to assume that Gage is going to be the third pass catching option behind Kyle Pitts yet either, given that he was targeted 110 times last year and 18 times in the red zone, good for 12th most in football and tied with players like DeAndre Hopkins and Keenan Allen. Gage was the wide receiver 37 on the season, but was top 25 in targets and receptions. You really would have liked to have seen him produce more in terms of yards and touchdowns, but barring an injury, that's definitely possible now that he'll play 17 games without Jones. The thing I like most about Gage, though, is he's playing on a team that won't sniff having a top-ranked defense this year and will once again be forced to throw the ball a ton. And sure, I like Mike Davis a lot as a value three-down back, but he's not talented enough to shift the Falcons to a more run-heavy team. Matt Ryan is averaging over 600 passing attempts per season across his last 9 years, and Arthur Smith is a welcome addition as Atlanta's new head coach. So as the 52nd wide receiver off the board, Gage offers a ton of upside in a pass-first offense that just lost one of the best receivers to ever play the game. I'm more than happy to draft him as the wide receiver 52 with a triple-digit ADP. I'm really excited about Michael Pittman this year, more than anyone else on this list. Not quite as excited as I was before Carson Wentz and Quentin Nelson suffered the same foot injury in the same week, but a lot more excited than I was before finding out that Wentz likely wouldn't need close to the possible 12 weeks to recover and get back on the field. Now, I'm not saying Wentz is going to be an MVP candidate with the Colts, but he's certainly better than Jacob Eason and Sam Ellinger. And the fact that Frank Reich has shown no interest in signing a veteran quarterback suggests that Wentz should be back sooner than later. Jim Irsay did state that he doesn't want to rush Wentz back until he's 100% healthy, but here's why I'm actually okay with it, even if Wentz does miss the first few games in 2021. Indy has a miserable schedule through the first 5 weeks, but it'll get way easier when Wentz inevitably returns. Both games against the Texans and the Jaguars will be after week five, along with some other really favorable spots. And this isn't even to say that Wentz misses 5 weeks. He almost certainly won't. I'm no medical expert, but I'd be surprised to see if he missed more than three. So with that in mind, Pittman has seen his ADP fall significantly since the Wentz injury, more than a full round to be exact. And it's not like he won't be on the field either. He'll just be playing with a lesser talent at quarterback through maybe 1, 2, or 3 weeks, maybe none. But Frank Reich knows how to run an offense. And I'd also like to think he can take Wentz from being arguably the worst quarterback last season to a fully competent quarterback who at the least isn't a hindrance on his receivers when he returns. Hell, Frank Reich was the Eagles' offensive coordinator when Carson Wentz was the MVP candidate before tearing his ACL late in the season. Pittman's been lighting it up in camp and has all of the tools to become an alpha receiver in this league, and also an elite red zone threat. Paris Campbell's played 9 games in 2 seasons, but he is creating some hype after a flashy catch in week 1 of the preseason. And T.Y. Hilton's coming off his worst full year in 10 seasons as a pro. Campbell is a perfectly fine sleeper at a 141 ADP too, but Pittman is in a position where he could become the clear-cut number one on an above-average offense and pay huge dividends once fantasy playoffs come around. Thanks as always for watching. Be sure to head over to awesomeo.com. Check out everything we've got going on the fantasy football front and in the daily fantasy football world, where we will be started very soon. All of our tools headed up by the number one ranked DFS player in the world, Awesomeo himself. Until next time, peace.